too distant future, just so that we can give the other little cub space to come out if it wants to. I don't think it's too frightened, though. I think it just wanted to go to sleep. Now, Sheila, you want to know why hyena cubs kill each other if they are the same sex? That doesn't always happen. It does occasionally happen. It's a dominance thing. And whilst the battle is decided very easily, is straight away in the beginning if it's a male or a female, because the male automatically takes a submissive role, especially with two female cubs, less so with two male cubs, but especially with two female cubs, neither wants to relinquish the dominance. So what ends up happening is, with their sharp teeth, if one of them is even slightly disadvantaged, slightly smaller, the other, the sibling, can potentially kill it. There's some disagreement as to how common it actually is, and how many hyena cub deaths are actually caused by other adult females rather than cubs. But perhaps that's just a desire not to believe it of these tiny, innocent-looking things. But it doesn't always occur. So we could make an assumption that because we've got two, we've got a male and a female here, or two males, and we could turn out to be completely off the mark. They might be two females. I doubt it, though. Just looking at them, already it seems like there's a distinctive difference in behavior. But we'll see. Little tail flicking. All right, hyenas. I think we're going to leave you to snooze. We'll give the other cub a chance to come out. And last question, milkman, will they give birth yearly? Yes, potentially, but generally there's a slightly longer gap between when they have their litters of cubs. So again, it might also depend upon ranking, but we've seen Madam give birth less, about a year after her, or just over a year after her previous litter. But generally it will be slightly more than that, a year and a half, sometimes even 2 years, before they give birth a bit late, before they give birth to their next set of cubs. So it is, and it's of course dependent upon the individual, just as it is for all mammals. Some will come into estrus sooner than others. Okay, Ribbon, well done, you clever girl. Your babies are beautiful. Thank you very much for the lovely morning. We're going to leave our little snoozing hyenas and go off in search of other things. Brent, of course, has been on the search for other things all morning. Let's go and see how his leopard tracking's going.
Well, not very well at the moment. Those tracks were completely obliterated by a herd of elephants. So we've got no sign of them. So I just heard something strange. It sounds maybe like some elephants down towards the Mawati. So we're going to head down there, and then I'm going to do a bigger loop, check around again, see if maybe he didn't cut slightly more south from where the last tracks were. But I've just heard also Tandi has been found inside Torchwood in the Mawanini River. So that was my next plan, to go Chitwa, but doesn't sound like there's too much else happening. That Tandi's crossed out. Now, this is an area Tingana does like a lot, this section through here. Now, it's actually where I saw him kill an impala on foot while I was tracking him. That was not too far from here. I can also see tracks of Tayla on the road. Maybe she also did it. Right, so I could see their tracks. I think we might, our first sighting of the morning, apart from the zebra, might be bushwalk. Now, let's see if, I think they might try to give us a fright. Let's get ready. Just in case. Oh, oopsie. There we go. Just in case they try to jump out of a bush, we'll just pop them on the head. this way they'll never jump out of a bush at me again. What do you think, Vim? I think it's a good plan. As Vim says, it's always a good plan to clobber someone. Now, as far as I know, I'm the only one who's jumped out of a bush to give people a fright so far, and I did that to James, which was very funny. But you never know, they might take an idea from me. Oh, I don't see their tracks anymore. Oh, where are they hiding? I think they took a shortcut. I can hear cesticulars alarming, and that sounds like they're a people alarm, not a leopard alarm call. Well, we'll just keep it close by. One should go nowhere without one stick in the bush. Ah, I spotted them. And their tracks came back on the road. Maybe they'll be near a puddle I can drive through quickly. Whee! That would be very funny if we managed to just go through a puddle next to them. Hello. Just in case you decided to jump out behind a bush, we were prepared. Oh, we heard it. We're not sure we heard it.
But there's so many hippo tracks going in there, and then it could isn't that there and that big pool of water? I think it's maybe.
Yeah, hippo fighting. Because we heard it. We heard that strange That's noise from up there.
Rhino. It's one of the two. But I think with all those tracks going straight through there, I think. You think Zingala?
Zingala from Bill. But there could be more.
We did hear another female calling in a drainage.
At the drainage. You were there and this.
Are you live?
Yeah.
Oh.
Ah.
Did you find them?
They're from above us. So guys, we're not sure what's here. So this is really exciting. So it's either hippo fighting, lion killing something, rhino fighting or elephant fighting. So we don't know. And that's the wonderful thing about being up here. And if it's hippo fighting, I think Taylor, Herbie and Craig have made the right choice to stay this side. And we'll go look in the vehicle in case we have to change gears quickly.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll go straight there.
I bet you're going to get lucky there.
No. They went this morning. Yeah. But the Mvubu tracks, they tried the Ingwen Gonzo. I'll tell you what happened. So we're tracking a leopard and the hippo destroyed the tracks. But those, I think it could be that Djuma. Because there's nothing coming south, so he could have gone north. And there are lion tracks everywhere up and down there as well. So he might just be hiding. Okay, well, while we go see what's making noises across there, we're going to jump over to Tayla and bushwalk. So, hi, bye, go to Tayla. Off you go.
Right, and back with us. Obviously, Brent's going to drive on past. And earlier we were chatting about porcupines and aardvark. Ooh, and there's a fly. And we've actually found some fresh, diggings of a porcupine. Come and look. So look at this. This is very, very typical now of, porcupine. Look at that hole dug right in over there. You'll see there won't be too many claw marks, but they're obviously going for whatever this was feasting upon over here. You can see that they were munching away. And it's pity that the ground is not so soft, because we would have had some amazing, really, really amazing porcupine tracks. You may have even seen the quills and things coming through here. Hang on, there's another digging. Come and look over here. Let's see what it was particularly looking for. It was obviously in this area last night. Ah, yes. Look. Footprints. Can you see that? So you can see exactly where it was sitting over here. Dig. And if you were uncertain, you thought I was talking nonsense, look at this. See how the porcupine, which is the largest rodent in Africa, has been gnawing on this root. So this is a complete giveaway. So whatever this root may have come from, whichever one of these plants that are around here, it was digging those up and feasting upon those. And it can be a bit of a pest in South Africa. A lot of farmers, unfortunately, still to this day, will cull porcupine. It's very, very sad, especially where there are big crops and things like that for them to feed on. They obviously think it's delicious and they're having a complete buffet. And as you can imagine, the farmers don't enjoy it too much. Let's see if we can pick up on any more signs. I'm not sure which way it was going. Like I said, is that what it was feeding on? Do you know what this is?
I don't know, but I know that
That's the big root. Look at this. There we go. Thanks, Herbie. So Herbie's found this. This is what the porcupine, the root that the porcupine was feeding on. I'm not certain as to what plant this is, but it's got, it looks like it's got little nettles and things on it, so I don't know if I'm going to touch it. It might cause a bit of an irritation. And I've learnt my lesson now as an adult, and very much as a kid, when picking up and touching plants that you don't know can often end up in, a sticky situation. Maybe we should just put that down there, but that's really funny. That's so amazing. And we've had the footprints now. We've seen what it's been feeding on. We'll have to find out, of course, what exactly that plant is. Let's see if we can see any more evidence. And not very often that you get to see where a porcupine has been sitting and actually feeding, which is quite nice. Very special, actually. Let's see if he's done any more work. Nothing so far. And also, whenever you see porcupines, they love to feed along right next to our roads. For what reason? I'm not sure. Whether the soil is nice and soft just off of the side of the road and makes it easier for them to dig, I'm uncertain. It seems as though that porcupine has stopped for the moment. Maybe it went round, had a little drink at that a pan of some sort. And well, it's quite exciting around here. I'm talking a little bit loudly. I should probably lower my voice a bit because we've heard all of those funny noises that were going on back there. But luckily, Brent's around and he'll aid us if we need rescuing. But of course, we're going to keep on searching. We heard a lion earlier. I must tell you, we did hear a lioness calling. Sounded like down that way, so that's where we're heading at the moment. And we're going to go across now to Jamie, who's still at that hyena den.
Not still at the den, unfortunately. We have left them for now. I just wanted to make sure that we didn't overstay our welcome and that the cub felt safe to come out. And we'll just slowly but surely get them used to the presence of the vehicles. It won't take long. Not with Ribbon being as relaxed as she is. So, Brian, leopard cubs now, huh?
Yeah, leopard cubs.
Leopard cubs now. Let's go find some leopard cubs. That's what I feel like. I feel like we're on a roll. What is going on? Hoopoe. Hello, Hoopoe. There is a Hoopoe in the middle of the road. My favorite bird name ever, or one of them. Based purely on the fact that it goes hoop hoop, hoop hoop, hoop hoop. The African Hoopoe. Now, we get them in Johannesburg everywhere. And they get very, very accustomed to people, to the point that I've seen one of them walk through somebody's legs that was so engrossed with its probing into the dirt to look for grubs and insects. And I think it's a bird that all of us who grew up in Johannesburg are very familiar with. Johannesburg, of course, has become basically a city forest. It's one of the greenest, in terms of trees and plants, one of the greenest cities in the world. And that's completely changed and shifted the bird dynamics in the city. And it's brought in all sorts of extraordinary, unexpected birds like kookles and special different species of cuckoo. Bop, bop. Got something? Of course, the nerves on the end of that bill are very sensitive to any kind of movement, any kind of vibration in the soil. They've got such stubby legs. The more I look at their legs, the more ridiculous they look. When you compare them to something like a lapwing. Plop, plop, plop. Well, Megan, you want to know why we see the hoopoes more frequently in the road, more so than other birds. I think that they like the roads, especially at this time of year, because it's slightly easier for them to wander around unimpeded by plants and grass. I think it's also just easier for us to spot them when they're in the middle of the road. But they seem particularly, they are one of the few probers that like these sorts of areas. Hardy-dars will tend to spend more time around the slightly wetter areas. That's a much bigger, that's an ibis obviously, but that's also a prober. And they're much larger, so I think it's actually easier for their bills to sink down into softer mud and sand, whereas for the hoopoes it's a bit more tricky. I mean, it's a bit less tricky because their bills are so thin. And I think that's one of the reasons. The other birds that we see regularly on the road, of course, lapwings, Franklin's spur fowl, they spend a lot of time on the road, and hornbills as well, digging through dung to search for insects. It depends on your time of year as well, which particular birds you're going to see where. Interesting thing I learned whilst watching these, doing these live safaris, is the fact that hoopoes actually have a little pantry that they collect their food. And I didn't understand why one had caught a giant grub and had then gone and placed it at the top of a dead leadwood. And then I later discovered, thanks to some of the viewers sending through the information, that they actually have a little pantry that they store. So there you go. You learn something new every day. I feel, anyway. What? No, just Ellies. Lots of Ellies. I wouldn't mind Ellies either, Brian. Nice elephant sighting.
Lots of little ones.
Lots of little ones playing. We're getting greedy now. Leopard cubs. Elephants. Even if neither of those things happen, I'm still going to be chuffed with our morning. An hour and a half spent at a hyena den. Can't beat it. And the excitement and the expectation of sightings to come. Little Hoopoe, I'm sorry. I need to come along this road. No, if you go and land in the middle of the road again, I'm going to disturb you again. Oh dear, here we go. Fly that way just for a second. Just for a second so I can come past. Oh, there we go. There's another bird in the road. It is a red-crested Korhann, I think, judging by the bottom I just saw disappearing. I'll show you in a moment. It's vanished behind the grass. Thanks, Hoopoe. Where'd you go? Oh, this long grass. Where'd it go? Up. Yep. I saw the grass moving as we came in. There he goes. I see you. There he is. Well done, Brian. Oh, thank goodness we have cameramen so very, very good at spotting subtly coloured creatures. And disappearing. Hello, red-crested Korhann. So, a relative of the Bustard family. We get the black-bellied Bustard most regularly out here. I still haven't seen a Cory Bustard while I've been working, but I know that they have been seen. Okay, this red-crested Korhann is playing hard to get, but there is a very large lump moving on the road in front of us that I suspect quite strongly is an elephant walking towards us. Lots of elephants! Many elephants! Marvellous. Hello, Ellies. Here we go. Got one wish already. And they're coming straight towards us. How perfect is that? Hello, Nelephants. Head up, checking us out, making sure we're not a threat. No, don't disappear. Okay, let's go a bit closer and find ourselves a good position where we're not in their way. Because at the moment, this termite mound is going to restrict them a little bit. Also, just the sound of the vehicle to let us know that let them know that what they're seeing, because they are quite... their eyesight's not very good. So that, as soon as they hear the vehicle, then they'll know to relax, because otherwise they can't see exactly what we are. Once we start to talk and they can see the vehicle and they can hear the vehicle, then they know we're not a problem. Hello, ladies. Our Jill, you want to, just while we get closer to our elephants, you want to know if there's a difference between the male and female hoopoe. Now, the males are just slightly bigger and their colours are slightly more vibrant, but it's not a big difference at all. Hello, ladies. Here we go. Let's just give them a bit of space. They seem to be all be gathering around a tree. There's a couple of little ones. It's always interesting to compare and contrast the different levels of sexual dimorphism with all animals. Female elephants, of course, much smaller than the males, but that's one of the sort of few differences between them. If you're just looking at them as a casual observer, you have to really look at the intricate details to the shape of their forehead, the size of the mammary glands between their front legs. It can actually be quite tricky with telling the difference between a young male elephant and a young female elephant if you haven't spent much time with Ellies. So don't vanish, you're all coming towards us so nicely. Look how tall the grass is. Even a two-year-old elephant calf is disappearing behind it and being shepherded, whilst a large female makes sort of positions herself between us and the rest of the herd. Make sure that we're not going to give them any nonsense. Okay. Hello, girls. Another thing to remember with elephants for our new viewers when you are approaching them from a vehicle is never to drive straight at them, A. B, never to put yourself directly in their path. Sometimes that's unavoidable, but if you can avoid it, that would be ideal. And then slowly. They don't like a vehicle racing towards them any more than you might. There's a big bull. Wandering off after the ladies. Have you had any luck, mister? Or are you just seeking a bit of company? Now, the bulls often spend time in the company of a breeding herd, scent checking the females to see if there's any sign of estrus or coming into heat and ready to mate. But also, I think they just enjoy the company every now and again, to be honest. And they spend their lives after they leave the herd quite solitary. Yes, yes, mister. There they go. Careful, you'll lose them. Oh, hello. Didn't see you. Here comes another elephant bringing up the rear. Another young bull. You can see what I mean about it being tricky, especially when you look at them at this sort of age, because they've got... Young males have angular foreheads as well. Oh, sorry, that is a female. Never mind. What utter nonsense I'm sprouting. It's a female. It's a cow just bringing up the rear. I wonder if there are any more. Or if we can just shift forward slightly. Don't forget, for viewers that have just joined us, perhaps you've just jumped on board, to send through your questions using the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter, or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. If there's something you've always wanted to know about elephants. And there we go, a question from Marcel that will require some reversing quickly. Marcel, you want to know if male elephants have mammary glands? No, they don't actually. I mean, what they have, I'm trying to show you between his front legs, they do have nipples and they do have sort of slight extensions, just as male humans have nipples on their chests, so do male elephants. Obviously, they don't serve any function, at least that we know of. They don't serve any function in the male elephants, whereas with the females you've got the extension of the mammary gland tissue, so the milk producing tissue, which makes them much larger and stick out more prominently, whereas the nipples between the front legs of a male elephant are much reduced. I can't show you now. Hopefully he turns ever so slightly. We've got a lovely view of his trunk though, and the way that he is utilizing it to feed himself. Now, mister, I'm sorry, we're closely examining your anatomy. He's closely examining the trees, seeing what might be nice to eat. I know what you're thinking. I know exactly what you're thinking. Sage, you want to know what the mating seasons are for elephants. I know what you want to do, so here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to turn around. Yeah. Yeah. He's trying to sneak up behind us so he can chase us. Alright, while we navigate around our elephant to make sure he doesn't come. Yeah, so you pretend all you want, mister. Let's go across to Tayla, who has a giant on foot.
Okay guys, so what we've got elephants. We've actually found ourselves, and it seems like there's a whole herd of elephants over here, so we need to keep our voices down. We're going to have to just check the wind. Craig, if you have a little, you might be able to have a little look at us. And then, okay, you see, a little elephant with a calf. Now this is something we don't want them to know, that we're here, we're not far away from them. There's almost no wind, and I know I'm whispering really softly, but I don't know where the rest of the herd is. We can hear their ears flapping because there's no wind today, so all we are hearing is, it's a strange noise, but we've been hearing it all over. So we've just got to make sure that we keep our wits about us today, because it is very, very thick, which is also good for us because it means that we can also hide away. But let's just check the wind quickly. You can see it's coming from the west and blowing straight towards the east. There's another one. But they're moving away for us. But remember, satellite parties. You've got to keep an eye out for them. We don't know if there are any more coming from the west coming towards us. So we've just got to make sure. So we're going to listen very, very carefully. So luckily, we don't have much wind today. It's slightly changing direction. Okay, let's come back here. We don't want them to see us. She hasn't picked up on us just yet. But you can see her moving through the trees. I don't know if she's going to come out and have a drink, perhaps at Jelly Pan. But we'll have to just keep in mind that we do not have the wind in our favour. We're not blowing downwind. She can't smell us, but if she walks a little bit further east, about another 80 yards or so, she will pick up on our scent. I do think, though, that most of the herd has already gone into the Mwati. I have a suspicion that perhaps she is sort of lurking towards the back. Come. She's picked up on us. She's picked up on us. Let's go. Are you sure? Let's just go see. Did you see when she came around the corner? We're fine. She lifted up her head a little bit. Looked around. I think she knows that something's here. Maybe she doesn't know quite what's going on. Let's just see. I'm just going to take a couple of steps back. Come and look. Look at the little ones coming out now. They don't know we're here. They were not watching Mum's cues. So what we'll do is we'll let them go and then we'll shuffle around the side of the bush and see if we can have a look at them. But we're close. We're probably about 60, 70 yards away. Okay, come. Just be very quiet with your feet. She's smelling. She's very funny. She's lifting up, but she's smelling with her trunk. She's not quite sure what's here, but come here. Go down a little bit. We're going to have to try and go down a little bit. Right, Louise, sorry, we need to go across to Jamie now. We've just got a couple of elephants out. We need to move a little bit quicker. So let's jump aboard back on Jamie's vehicle.
While Tayla navigates her way out of that elephant sighting, and of course we're always very, very cautious with things like elephants on foot, you are back on board with us once again as we go off in search of Shadow. Now the question is, where has Shadow moved her cubs to? Are they still okay? I hope they should be. Fingers crossed they are. I doubt she would have moved them into this end of Djuma. This is sort of the western fringes of her territory. And the reason I say that is just because of the amount of hyena activity. Although, if she goes further west, she's got the other clan, the much, much larger clan, to deal with. It's impossible to predict exactly where she's going to be and what she's going to do. I think I'm going to go and have a look at Red Dam, just because I know she likes that area. And go and see whether or not she's popped out there. And actually go and have a look and see how full Red Dam is. Might also be a nice thing to have a look at. Whoopsie, millipede. Sorry, Brian. Don't want a squashed millipede. Yesterday evening I was on bushwalk and we were walking back along this road. Quite rapidly, I might add, because the sun disappeared sooner than we expected to. But we were being followed by a hyena the entire way home. Could just hear it whooping in the background. Never saw it, but it just kept coming along Zoe's road behind us. They do that a lot. It's quite entertaining. You go out on tracking team. It's happened to me on multiple occasions here. You go out and you're on tracking team following a drag mark, and all of a sudden you've got company. You look across and there's a hyena looking at you. And then they follow you for a little bit to see what you're getting up to, and then off they go. The hyena is not dangerous to a human being on foot. Elephants, lions, any of those sorts of animals absolutely have the potential to be dangerous, but hyenas, unless you are sleeping out in the open, which we of course would strongly advise you not to do, but unless you're sleeping out in the open, there's no threat from a hyena. Look, it's Herbie's black-bellied Bustard. It's Herbie's buddy. It's the same one that Herbie had a long conversation with a couple of months ago on bushwalk. He now talks about it as his friend. Every time we come past this junction and we hear him calling. So that's the cousin of the bird that we attempted to show you earlier. You only really saw the top of its head. This is its slightly larger cousin, the black-bellied Bustard. And I always feel the need to do this. That's Bustard. I forgot how to spell it there for a second. No. Bustard. Never mind. I'm going to stop before I find myself in trouble. The black-bellied Bustard makes one of the best bird calls of any bird. A whistle and then champagne cork pop. Brian, would you do the honors for us?
Let's see if it talks back.
Let's see. Brilliant, Brian. Well, okay. We're going to leave Brian to converse with black-bellied Bustard. Let's go and see how Taylor's doing with her Ellies.
See that you managed to find Herbie's friend. Move very quickly early, and I promise you we are all safe, we are all fine. It's just because of this mother and her little calf, who is tiny and probably less than about 6 months old. So she came out of the very thick bushes and we thought that we'd heard somebody else. And then I think we just assumed that it was one of the calves from the previous female that we're looking at. So she snuck out of the bushes and very calm. So we quickly retreated. We used bushes to hide our bodies. She doesn't even know that we're here yet. And now we've got the wind perfectly in our favor because it seems to be blowing down towards us, which is fantastic. And she's relaxed. She's eating. I know it might be an obscured view, but that's fantastic for us because that means that she has absolutely no idea that we are here. So we'll just keep our voices down And we're up on a termite mound, so we're able to see above the shrubs now, which helps as well, because there are so many quarry trees around here that when you are standing down, it's almost impossible to see anything. And how many elephants, especially when they are less than 6 months old, they're almost invisible behind some of these trees. But I think she's moving very, very slowly straight towards the pan as well, where I'm sure she will have a drink. And I'm sorry we didn't get to have a good look at that elephant having a drink of water, but she's walking exactly where we were sitting. So we would have got ourselves into a very sticky situation, which you do not want when you're on a walk. Remember I said to you, it's not just the one elephant that you need to watch. You need to make sure you don't come in between females, well, different groups of females and their calves, because that's when everything can go pear-shaped very quickly. So that's why we whisper, we keep as quiet as we can on a bushwalk so that we can hear the subtle signs. Like I said, what gave her presence away was when she was flapping her ears. I don't think necessarily keeping her cool now, it's not too hot just yet, but I reckon that the flies and little biting insects are probably bothering her. So she flaps them every now and then quite hard against her back, and it creates a sound. You can see she's flapping them there. And we're fine here, we have got higher ground. So something like an elephant wouldn't necessarily want to challenge you when you are standing up on higher ground, because you're now taller than them. There she goes. Look how cool that is. Isn't this amazing that we're able to have these interactions on foot? Hello, Michael Octopus. You were wondering how many pounds of food does an elephant need to eat daily? Well, an elephant, a fully grown elephant, needs to eat 5% of its body weight every single day. Can you believe that? That's a lot of food. So a cow like this is probably eating, I would say, between 150 and 200 kilograms of vegetation. So just probably less than 500 pounds of vegetation, of leaves, of branches. It might seem that I'm a little bit distracted, but of course we are on a walk. I have got Herbie scanning out, but the more eyes, the more ears, the better. So you'll see me just looking around every now and then, and you have to do that. It was always funny when guiding guests, and if I was on my own and I just had a couple of guests with me, a very small group, you have to do all of this. You've got to talk, you've got to look out for your surroundings. So I'd be telling stories, and you know I love a good story, and I'd be doing this, telling stories and looking around over my shoulder, just making sure that nobody was trying to sneak up onto us. Now, I can't see her anymore, but she's actually feeding. She's facing us at the moment. You might be able to just see her ears. Here she is. And we're... There's actually more coming out at the back. Oh my goodness, that's actually a very big herd that we've got here. Perhaps it's the same herd that we saw yesterday. If this cow does come any closer, what I'll do is I'll sit nice and quietly. They're just coming out of every crevice of the bush. It's wonderful. But like I said, we are safe. We are on a termite mound. We've got the wind in their favor. We know where they're going. They're going towards Chelepan. So we should be fine. So don't panic if you're panicking. I'm not panicking yet. Now, Christina, you've asked, at what age is an elephant considered to be full grown? Well, it depends if it's a male or a female, but they take a long, long, long time to grow. And I would say a female elephant is probably considered fully grown, maybe at about 20 years, somewhere around there. I reckon she's probably reached her peak. She might fill out a little bit more. And a bull, well, when they get to about 30, between 30 and 35 years old, they're really only sexually mature. They're coming into mass normally for the first time, if there are a lot of other big bulls in the area. But this is amazing. And you can just, I wish you could hear it. It might be a bit too soft, but they are the most subtle sounds. You've got all the birds calling behind us, which is obviously a distraction. You can see she's just moving past us now. So when she flaps her ears, or when she pulls out a piece of grass or takes some leaves off of branches, you can hear those things. Remember, it is so thick out here. There's a little baby just following just behind mom, and they have no idea that we're here. This is so exciting. Right, we're not going to push this too much longer. This has been another fantastic elephant sighting. We'll let them carry on with their day. We're going to head, well, in the opposite direction, and Brent has got a squirrel.
Oh, the squirrel's just jumping around, but it's very interesting because it's a mother moving a tiny baby. I'm just going to try and move forward. So it's actually, oh, she's on the ground. How quick was that thing? So she's got a baby in her mouth, and she's obviously moving densites. Now let's try and get another view of that, or a view, let's be honest. And where's she gone? Oh, it's so thick at the moment. Oh, I thought I saw some movement. Was it my imagination? No, she's disappeared. Darn it! So, we have now... we checked up on that noise that was happening around the pan. Unfortunately, it looks like it was just hippos, but they'd already moved off. And we're now checking for shadow. And we found tracks of shadow, but from yesterday. So, not fresh. So, we're just checking now between Djuma and Arathusa, seeing if there's any sign of her popping out somewhere. Now this is the area that when Sindile got to about 7 months or so old that she used to leave him regularly was in this little river system here. Those of you who are not sure who Sindile is, Sindile is Shadow's last cub that made it, or only cub that made it to adulthood. She doesn't have the best track record as a mother. And you got something, Vim? Let's have a quick look. The road is so hard, I don't want to even try reverse and move the vehicle around to have a look. But let's have a look. A little piece of log. Oh, those are much nicer tracks than the other ones. Well spotted, Vim. Going in there. So into Arathusa. Great spot. I mean, those tracks were pretty much near invisible. I wonder where she popped out from. Now those tracks are from last night rather than from yesterday, so they are much better. I'm just gonna turn around. That was a great spot of the track by them. Let's find a good spot to do our turning. Oh, it flew away. Alright, so it seems like Jamie might have had the same plan as us. Because I'm almost 100% confident that Karula's not back, and neither are Shungile and Hassane. So we decided to have a look around here. And I'll show you the track that VM spotted now. There we go, you can see where I've marked with my foot. There's the track there. Well spotted, VM. Not quite as fresh as those male tracks we had, but definitely worth following up on. Now comes spot the invisible footprint game. Especially on a main road like this. Now we just want to make sure she hasn't gone into Djuma. And I know Jamie is coming up behind us. Just have a quick look here. There's a path that goes in. That Shadow used to use quite a bit when she used to spend a lot of time here. And also it's a drain, so I've got a better chance of seeing tracks on the softer soil. Nada. Have a careful look. Now, see, the problem is she takes one step onto here and you've got delivery vehicles, you've got all sorts of cars that are people coming on safari, people leaving from their safari. So this is always a very challenging place to find tracks. Just make sure she hasn't gone back into Djuma around here. Shadow being shadow and hiding in the shadows somewhere. Jamie has now caught up with us. She is trying to bump the tire behind us. And Brian.
Hi.
Hi. Yes, there's tracks there. No, you can go ahead. I'm not sure where she's gone, but the last track's just down there. And there's tracks from her yesterday going in and out between Hoffman's and Djuma. Brian, loving the camera.
Always.
Brian, don't you think it's time for a beard trim?
I'll never trim this beard ever again.
I'm going to hold you to that.
Oh. Oh, thank you, Jim.
Now, VM is focusing on Jamie. He doesn't realize this. There we go.
I was just wondering whether you're going to roll backwards ever so slightly.
Uh-oh. Okay, so we can't see where she's gone. I haven't heard any updates from Arathusa whether they found tracks of her elsewhere. There's a track. Is it? No, it's a white-tailed mongoose. Now, the only problem is this whole section of Arathusa we can't actually drive into. She come back that side now. Oh, Vim is on fire today. So we can't really drive in this area because it is clay soils. So VM says she came, where was it? Whereabouts? Check here, it looks like she's coming in.
Right below your foot.
Oh, there we go, well spot. Yo, VM is on fire today. I saw them already. We're not looking for elephants, Brian, we're looking for leopard. Okay, so where's she go from there? Looks like she's carrying on this really well-used road. I'll wait for them to take his jersey off. I won't move too much. It suddenly got really hot. The temperature has suddenly jumped probably about 10 degrees, 15 degrees. And you can almost imagine the damp, the steam coming off everything that's damp at the moment. Oh dear, these leopards are giving us a hard time this morning. Well, of course, Jamie's also here having a look for the for shadow. So let's go see if she finds any tracks down the fire break.
Oh, it is not easy tracking this morning. This fire break is sodden, but not quite sodden enough for a leopard to leave a proper imprint. I think she's probably crossed into this drainage and I've just missed the tracks going across. Just because that's one of her favorite areas. She likes to be there. And by drainage system, basically what I mean is it's kind of like a dried up creek. It's basically where water over many years has cut into the land, and you've got some really pretty trees that grow there, some lovely, lovely tamboerti thickets. But it does make for the perfect habitat for a creeping leopard to hide in. And she does love that spot. Where'd that elephant go? Oh, there. Here we go. There's the elephant that Brian spotted, that Brent spotted ages ago, apparently. Sure. I'm going to take this opportunity to take my jacket off because all of a sudden it's gone from chilly to roasting in the space of 2 minutes, Brian?
Yep.
Give or take? Yep.
The cookathon has commenced.
Brian is absolutely correct. It is a time of extremes at the moment. There's lots and lots of elephants, which does make tracking leopards quite tricky when you can't go walking around them and when they've walked all over your tracks. I've just checked Zoe's road. I didn't see any tracks coming out. I'm sure she's in this drainage. I wonder whether or not she's brought the cubs here. It would be lovely. Sorry, I know we're looking at elephants. I'm busy talking about leopards. I've just got the tracking idea on the brain. Brent. I would try and radio Brent, but my radio is not working. Lou, if you could pass that message on. I was trying to let him know that I didn't see anything crossing, but it's so wet we might have missed it. My radio does not want to broadcast anything. And that I've checked Zoe's road. I've done that too. There was nothing there. And these elephants look perfectly relaxed. And there's one thing an elephant does not like, apart from chilies. It is a predator. Any kind of predator. Leopard, lion, wild dog, hyena. If they see a predator, if they smell a predator, they will chase it away. They just, for some reason, even if it's something that is completely unable to hurt them or to harm them, they just can't stand the presence of them and they will chase them. Now, leopards are quite good at remaining undetected by elephants, though. You've seen it with Hosanna playing games with elephants. Sneaking up on them, as all young male leopards love to do. You can give us heart failure every now and again. Well, leopards are good at remaining undetected. They're probably the predator that's chased the least by elephants out of all of them. Here we go. Slow and steady march into Hoffman's. I think she's in here, Brian. I'm almost convinced. I wonder if she... There's not that many suitable den sites in here. Possible. Potential den sites. Nice tamburti thicket. She might keep the cubs in there. Really, ideally, a leopard's looking for a nice crevice, rock hang, something like that. Something that the cubs can remain quite secret and safe. Difficult. Difficult, difficult to try and guess where she might be. She used to bring Sandile here all the time. It was one of... We used to find Sandile here on a regular basis. Brian, didn't you get charged in there by Shadow with Brent?
Yeah, I did.
When we found the drag mark and Brent was on tracking team. Oh, we've got a spider. Brent was on tracking team and had Brian with him. That was back in the day, Brian, when you could do such things. And they encountered Shadow on foot and she gave them a little bit of a rev. A little bit of a growl. Ellies, you have stomped all over the place. If there were leopard tracks here, I don't know how we would spot them. Well, let's take a chance. Maybe she'll be here. While we stutter forward in second gear low range, let's go back across to Tayla to find out how her walk is going.
Jamie, I'm very itchy now. After, well, us moving away from those elephants, I managed to walk straight through some nettles of some sort. Now the bottom of my legs are exceptionally itchy and you can see they're very dirty because I was scratching them with my shoe, and it feels lovely when the sand exfoliates against your legs. So now Herbie says he's going to show me a trick on how to cure itchiness, and particularly if a nettle indeed stings you and makes you itch. Let's see, he said something to do with a marula tree. Do you want a knife, Herbie?
Yes, please.
Herbie needs my knife. Let's give him my knife. Here we go. So I'm not exactly sure what he's going to do, but he said something about the cambium layer. So let me quickly explain to you what the cambium layer is on a tree. So it's basically the inside layer on, well, the inside of the hard grey bark that you see on, well, we're talking about a marula tree now. And on the inside, it's almost red in color. And that is the layer where nutrients are transported through. So from the roots all the way up to the top of the leaves. So if you ring bark a tree, if you strip away all of the bark right down to the cambium layer, the tree will eventually die because it's impossible to be able to get any nutrients to the tops of the leaves. So look what Herbie's doing now. You can actually see. You can see that bright red. And it's also always very obvious when an elephant has been feeding on the bark of a marula tree, because often their tusks have got bits of red colouring on them. Right, what do I do with this, Herbie? Just rub it on my legs. Right, let me come out of the long grass. Just stand here on the road so you can see. So Herbie says, you can, if you see, it's nice, it's full of moisture, it's quite wet. He says that I must just rub it on. Let's rub it on. Leg number one done. Yeah, turning a bit red too, which is nice. It can make me look like I've got a bit of a tan. Let's get the sand off of my knee. Wonderful. So I'm sure we'll have to wait a couple of minutes before the itchiness subsides, but we'll see how well it works. Luis just reminded me that sunburn is red and the suntan is brown. Some of us are not blessed with olive skin, like me. I got the fair genes, as you can imagine. Though if I sit in the sun for long enough, I can go really, really tanned. But these days, I'm not bothered by that. I'd rather keep the sun off of my arms. I've got lots of freckles from running around outside as a kid all the time. And obviously, wearing sunscreen, or not wearing enough sunscreen, probably is telling big stories to my mom when she'd yell out, "Taylor, do you have enough sunscreen on?" And I'd go, "Yes, Mom." You know what children are like. I'm pretty sure I did that for most of my life, and as a repercussion, I am now covered in freckles, which I dislike. Anyway, so we try and cover as much of myself up, especially in this area. It's particularly hot, and I used to always guide without long sleeves, and then I decided when I moved to Zambia that it would probably be a good decision when the days get to well over 90 degrees Fahrenheit, and most of the days would actually be in the early 100 degrees, and you can imagine the sun is exceptionally harsh, and I thought to myself, I got burned one day when I did my guide training up there as well, and I thought to myself, it's not worth it. And then, well, after that, I started wearing long sleeves. I still wear shorts, and I don't put suntan lotion on my legs, but it's definitely a good idea to wear the biggest hat that you can find so that it covers your face, and then, of course, protective clothing. So even if you come on a safari holiday and your skin is not used to the harsh sun, so it's particularly Europeans, I've seen it many a times where, unfortunately, guests will get heat stroke and things like that, and it's not pleasant. It will ruin your entire holiday. Get a light sort of linen shirt, long sleeve shirt, especially for the afternoon safaris. The mornings are not so bad. The sun is not too harsh just yet, but the afternoons you're still going out and it'll get you. It's there, so just be careful for walking as well. It's quite nice. I walk in shorts, which can be a little bit silly because you pick up a lot of thorns and things across the way. So I'd recommend if you went walking and you didn't want to be covered in scars afterwards, unless you've gone in winter where it's nice and open and there isn't much grass around, then you'll be all right. Otherwise, get a pair of long pants to wear as well. It's good just to stay covered up, keep the insects off you, they're very annoying all the time. And then, of course, the most importantly, keeping the sun off of your skin. I think that's probably one of the things that people sort of forget about when coming on safaris. Yes, they pack sunscreen and they pack a hat and sunglasses, but they don't realize how important it is to actually cover up, because, well, let's face it, sunscreen can only do so much. Sometimes you need a bit of more of a barrier between your skin and the sun. Otherwise, you can cover yourself in mud. Oh, this is a question I haven't been asked in a very long time, and it's come from Dylan, and he would like to know this fine summer's day if there are any baobabs in the Greater Kruger area. There are indeed. There are actually plenty. If you just go a little bit further into the Manuleti, I could imagine that there's some. I think there's probably a couple scattered in the Sabi Sand, not many though. And the further north in Kruger, sort of once you get past Skakuza, there's a very southern baobab in the Greater Kruger area, or in the Kruger National Park exactly, and then once you go further past that, they start to pop out. We had lots of baobabs in Zambia. They were everywhere. We had more baobabs than we had marula trees. We actually had a lot of false marulas, which don't develop. They're lovely, tasty fruits, and I love a baobab tree. I think they're probably one of the most amazing trees to climb in, and I'll never forget, there was a baobab at my school in the Eastern Cape. It was obviously planted there, my primary school, so the first school I went to, and I always used to climb it. Luckily, we don't get black mambas down there, because I don't know how willing I'd be to climb up a baobab tree now in these areas, because I don't know if you've ever seen one, but I kid you not, some of the trunks of baobab's tree can be the width of this road. I promise you. We saw massive ones where we had, I think it was about 10 of us, maybe even 12 of us, standing around holding hands, and that was the circumference of the tree. This was a massive one in Zambia, and that must have been hundreds of years old. So they get really big, They've got big crevices in them. The elephants love to feast upon them. Bees like to use them to make their hives inside of them. And, well, snakes will find refuge in, of course, like I said, all the little crevices that are in a baobab tree. So lovely to have around, and it's sad that we don't get to see them here. But maybe one day, you never know. As we start to extend our traversing areas and we're going all sorts. So basically, I think we're so lucky now, we're starting to go to more and more places on Safari Live. You know, we're going to Kenya soon and all these different places. So hopefully we'll start to see different vegetation too. And hopefully one of them will be a baobab tree. Wouldn't that be lovely? Could imagine James sitting in a baobab tree, but he better be very careful. Right, Jamie's managed to get herself out of, I think, a little gremlin spot over there. So let's pop across her to her. I think she was with the elephants. I think she's moved on now, but let's go take a look.
Moved on because our Ellies. There was much the resolution and moving. Elephants moved on to the south, I moved on to the east. Sadly, it seems as though, well, not sadly actually, it's just that Shadow's tracks have gone into the zoned area. Any flogs? No flogs. To the zoned area. Site was, and until the guides, the head guides from those properties let us know that, get off my lip fly, let us know that it's okay for us to go there, obviously we'll give it plenty of room. They will keep checking on her, make sure she's okay, and hopefully we'll be able to give you an update about her on the sunset safari. We'll try and get hold of them. Aha! The end product, Brian, of the dramatic fights and scenes that we had not so long ago in this particular puddle. Tadpoles! Tadpoles everywhere. And I'm going to have a guess and say these are bullfrog tadpoles. I think that would be a relatively fair assumption, given the scenes that we saw a few days ago. Phew! Frantically fluttering about. I'm sure James would be very excited to see these, given his fascination with tadpoles. Oh, there you go. There might not be any more fighting bullfrogs, but you can see why there was such a sense of urgency. Because this puddle is a perfect spot. There's no tilapia that are going to eat them, no other fish that are going to eat them. But these tadpoles had better do some very quick growing. Here come some Ellies again. Oh my goodness, there's Ellies everywhere. How lovely. I'm never going to complain about lots of Ellies. I wonder if they're going for a bit of a mud bath. Let me see. Let me go forward. Anyway, suffice to say those tadpoles better grow quickly because that puddle's going to dry up if it stays this temperature. Oh, there's another little one. Shame. I know Brent was looking for Ellies for the VR team. Okay. Not slow moving either. No stopping for a mud bath here. Something's got them a little on edge. They're moving very, very rapidly. There's a tiny little one with them. Oh, I know why they're moving so rapidly. There is a rather large bull. That's why these elephants are so stressed. There's a big male coming through at the back. All right. Ooh, lots of talking. Lots and lots of talking happening here. Hi guys. I'm sorry, has he been bugging you today? You can see they're stressed out. Not too bad, but tail's not relaxed and swinging, and lots of secreting happening from the temporal gland. They've been anxious, they've been running, they've been nervous. Hello, little boy. And you? What have you got to say for yourself? You look like you're full of nonsense. Were you going to be? Hi guys. Shame. I think they've been that there's a massive bull. I thought I smelt a must bull earlier. I think that might be him. And when they're in must, they tend to be quite persistent and quite pushy with the other elephants or the female elephants in the herd, checking to see if they're in estrus, pushing the youngsters around, kind of really just getting in the way and upsetting everybody's mood. Sorry, bear with me 1 second. Just because Brent and Elephants, I know he was searching for them. I'm just going to patiently wait for my opportunity to let him know. Lovely. They're all coming out into the road in front of us, which is perfect. There's... Oh, look at the little one, Brian. Hi, baby. Sure, that's a tiny calf. That is a very, very tiny calf. Okay, Mommy. It's all right. I'm just sitting here. I'm not going to hurt your baby. Sure, that's a tiny baby. Okay. No wonder they're so stressed as well. Tiny babies tend to make the entire herd quite anxious and very protective. It's all right, Mum. Look at the sibling on the right there. Oh, sorry, on your left. Protecting the baby as well. That's what I love about elephants. There is such an amazing bond between the various members of the herd. Okay. Brent. All right, guys. Okay, let's look at this tiny little one. It is so sweet. Look at how all the females are coming to make sure this baby's okay. This is phenomenal. She called them. That female, the mother of that small calf, called the other females to come and make sure she's okay. Just provide a little bit of backup. It's okay. Needs a little break. Hey, little one, have they been walking you far? It's okay, Mom. It's okay. Alright, I'm going to sit with this utterly adorable baby elephant as it moves off. And let us send you across to Tayla with a firefly larvae.
Now this is very interesting. As Jamie said, we've got a firefly larvae here, and they are ferocious predators. And it looks like it is digging down into the burrow of a harvested termite nest. You can see all the grass pieces surrounding it, so that's a giveaway that this is the nest, or at least the start of a colony of harvester termites, probably living underneath here, and it's typical to see them out on the road. Now, we've told you a couple of times that some of the, well, the culprits of feasting upon the African giant land snails are indeed this fella that we're looking at now, the firefly larvae. And they're known for eating slugs and snails. I didn't know that they fed upon termites too. So this is really, really interesting. It's trying to get something, but I can imagine it's quite a large larvae. So I think it's probably struggling to get down into some of those chambers. They become quite narrow. Look at it, it's definitely wriggling around, and I'm hoping it's going to pull something up as well in a moment. We've just got to be a little bit patient. Maybe it's stuck now because it seems to have stopped moving for a moment. Are you alive, fella? What are you looking for? No, it's not moving at all. I'm just going to move out the way quickly. You're going to hear a bit of noise, but Aubrey's going to just come past in the vehicle. Right, we'll just let Aubrey come past very quickly. I'm going to move past and then we'll take another look. Ah, so it's stopped. So I think it's maybe got itself into a little bit of a situation here where, well, it's unable to move. Hopefully, there it's twitching again. Maybe it's just waiting patiently now and it's going to try and grab a termite as it walks past. That's another possibility. It's obviously difficult because we can't see what's happening underground. But we're going to go back across now into Brent's vehicle. And I just bumped in him and he said he was searching for those elephants that we saw.
Well, we got distracted on our elephant search with a juvenile Bateleur. I'm pretty sure it's eating termites. I can't see any alates or flying ants flying around. Maybe that's because the Bateleur is not even letting them get a chance to fly. Oh, there's a Birchill starling as well. So there's definitely some form of insect around there that they're all feeding off. Very hungry. Let's try sneak a little bit closer. Maybe we can see what it's eating. And just let the car run for a second till it relaxes again. Birds of prey always look a bit ridiculous. Oh, off he goes, on the ground. Oh, beautiful. Lovely camera work for him. Now let's go have a look what it was eating. Right here. Somewhere right here. Ah, there we go. Harvested termites. So it wasn't eating alates, it was eating harvested termites that are busy collecting grass after the rain. Where's their hole? Ah, there's one. They often have multiple holes, and you can always see by the little bits of grass around the outside that have been discarded by the quality control. So they'll bring in lots of different bits of grass, and there'll be a termite right at the entrance who decides, no, 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 that grass is not good enough, throw it away. Off you go, get us another piece. Very cool. Now, we're going to try to find that herd of Ellies that Tayla had. I can't hear them, but they were in this area. Everything seems to be avoiding us today. Hi, Meg. Meg is wondering what is the largest herd of elephants I've ever seen. Well, the biggest grouping of elephants I've ever seen in South Africa is probably around 100. I've seen it in the Kruger, and I have seen it in Zululand as well. But I'd say it's not so much as a single herd, but the largest groupings of elephants I've ever seen have been in northern Botswana, and over a 20 kilometer area you can see over 1,000 easily, and Chobe waterfront, Kwando River, that area. Okay, so Tayla said I must just drive up the Mawati and we should find those Ellies, so let's go have a look. Hopefully they're still here. Now, even the elephants seem to be avoiding us. I know Jamie keeps finding elephants. There they are. We found them. They are still here. Thank goodness. Not everything is hiding from me today. And we got elephants on the right. And I think we're going to get the best view a little bit further up. Trying to see where the little ones are. Oh no, they're all moving out to the thickets. Yes, you're very scary, mister. But most of the Ellies are up to the right, where he's off to. It's a young bull on the peripheries. The rest of them are almost out of sight in this very thick riverine bush. Hey, big guy. And it's always beautiful being in these little riverbeds with animals. Where are you off to? And see, we're heading towards a massive African ebony tree. Now you can see how big that tree is. If we zoom out a bit, and you can see how small the elephant is. That is a very big tree.
So we're actually going to do a tracking exercise at the moment. Have a look over here. So, right, are you ready for this? We're going to label them. I want to try and find one that will help you out. Okay. Over here. This track. This is number one. So have a good look at it. Let me give you my hand next to it for a size reference so you can see. So track one, send your answers through hashtag Safari Live or questions at WildEarthTV as an email address. Number one, I hope you've got that one. It's quite big. We're going to come over here. We're going to do some of these. We'll do this one over here. Oh no, I've wrecked that one. Let me do it where I can make a circle. Yeah, this one. Here we go. That's number two. Have a look at that. Very small. Let me put my hand on this side. See that? Really, really tiny little track. Hashtag Safari Live again on Twitter with what you think track number two is. Now we need to find one more. Have you got one more, Herbie? Where's a good one? We'll try and give you an easy one. This is a nice road because it's so sandy. So I've been wanting to do a tracking exercise all morning. Herbie's come back over here. Herbie, I don't even know what that is. Herbie, I think that's going to be too difficult to have a look at. Okay, it's not bad. It's okay. This one, we can do this one, I suppose. I think, Craig, come this side and look at the track this way. Then you might get it. So this is track number three. It's in here. You can see there's a bit of disturbance, but the track is this. You see that? This will be, we'll put number three here. Number three. Now you can share them as screenshots, of course, as well. This is a tough one. This is not an easy one because even I'm struggling to have a look at it, but we'll just throw it in. We might get a couple of professionals who have seen something like this before and tried to, almost been fooled once, but won't be fooled a second time. So you'll probably get it. So hopefully we're going to hear from you. Who have we got flying up there? Is that a Bateleur, Herbie? Looks like it, eh? The Bateleur flying. I wonder if it isn't the same one that Brent has just had, because we're not far from Brent. But it didn't look like an adult just yet. This one looked like a juvenile. It still looked a bit brown. It didn't quite have its beautiful white wing paneling like the adults have. And off it goes. It's a beautiful day. I think the vultures, I think the Bateleurs, the tawny eagles, everybody's going to be exceptionally happy now that the clouds have lifted, because I suspect that there will be many thermals for them to catch. So Louise, have we had any guesses at our tracking quiz just yet? Right, so we've got a guess for number one. Paul, you said that this is a giraffe track. This one over here. Ooh, a little bit. Giraffe is a good guess. Almost the right shape, but this is a little bit too small. Let me put my foot next to it. Look at my foot in comparison with the size of that giraffe track. It's not a giraffe track. I'm not going to tell you what it is. We'll wait for a few more guesses. And then remember, we'll show you again that one we're doing. Here's number two, this track over here. This is a very small one. Mac and Weezer, you've guessed that this track, number two, is a common diker. Almost a little bit bigger. So think a little bit bigger. And I'll give you a tip. We'll change it up a bit here. When you are tracking, you must never look at what the assessor has just circled, because that's how they catch you. They'll find the most difficult track to have a look at. So look around you. So the only thing you're not allowed to do is step inside or touch that track that's circled, but that doesn't stop you from touching or looking at anything else that's around it. So have a look what's around this track. And this is actually a very easy one. You should all get this one now that we are giving you a tip and we're showing you what else is around here. You'll see that there are many other footprints left in the ground. But you were right in guessing that it's definitely an antelope. Now we just need to figure out which antelope do we have. Do we have any guesses for number three yet, the trickiest of tricky tracks? Should we have a look again? Let's take another look. Now there's one part of the track that should give it away, and that's this section over here. That little spot. Ah, Liz, you've said that. Did you say Liz or Lynn, Louise? Lynn, sorry, Lynn. So you've guessed that number one was a zebra, number two was an impala, and number three was an elephant. Well, Lynn, I can tell you that you got two out of three there. You are correct in saying that number three is an elephant track. So let me show you why it is an elephant track. This is the toenail that you've got over here. Here's the foot. It's not a brand new track. It's got a little bit of water damage. See, it's coming around. Here's the foot. There's a very, very faint line going all the way back around again. So that's from the elephant. So well done there. Number one, though, unfortunately, you didn't get correct. Who is going to get this track correct? Number one. Look at it again. Very, very broad, very sort of square. Let me move that leaf out of the way for you. Don't look at that, though. That's got nothing to do with the track. That's not a false hoof or anything over here. And remember, the sand is soft. You can see this animal has sunk in, and there's no presence of false hooves over here. So I'll help you a little bit. We know that if it was a buffalo, we would have seen an impression. Now, I'm wrecking the track. I'm doing what you shouldn't do, but I'm just quickly demonstrating over here. You would see false hoof marks. So it's not a buffalo. So it's something else. Oh, Kyle, that is a very, very good guess. Kyle has guessed that this is perhaps a warbuck, almost. Now, often when you start tracking, you get a waterbuck track confused with something else. So what is the animal that you can confuse a waterbuck track with? Think very hard. A warbuck. Warbuck. Rebecca Louise is now teasing me with my pronunciation. I'm sorry I've got such a terrible accent. It's horrible. So we're still guessing, but we've figured out. Let's just have a look again, because Lynn got the impala track right. A very easy track, impala. There's not many animals that have the footprint like an impala, and of course the sizing. The size is between 5 and 5.5 centimeters, so it's not a particularly a big one. And but you can just see very sort of heart-shaped over there. And then, of course, you're very rarely just going to see one impala track. So look around. You should see a lot of evidence of many, many more impalas walking through here. But quite wide at the back, the narrowest point of the track is at the tip of the hooves. And then it's sort of got big lobes. It looks very much like a heart. Ooh, irrelevant. You got close. You've said that is, number one, a kudu. Now, a kudu track is... Jamie's coming past us. We'll let it come past because we're off on the side of the road. So basically, a kudu track, it isn't a kudu track, the good guess. A kudu track is quite long. It almost does that. And I, no, that's too thick. Now I'm trying to draw it. Let me draw it with a stick so I can draw it narrowly. But it's quite long. And it's quite narrow. And the widest part of a kudu track will be in the middle. That is very typical. Yeah, Jane, you are the Tarzan of the bush. You've guessed correctly. Jane has said that this is a wildebeest track. You are indeed right. Well done to that. And it does look very much like a waterbuck track. The problem is that this track is very, very wide, very broad at the base over here. And you can see there's a big gap between the toes as well, the front of the hoof. And this looks like probably the front foot to me. And then the smaller one over here, because remember, all the weight is in their shoulders, so their front feet are a little bit bigger than their back feet. And I'd suspect that this is probably a back foot over there. But quite a broad track, a waterbuck track, would actually look a little bit more like this, just over here. She just over here, of course, and then slightly smaller as well, but the back of their hooves sort of splay out quite wide. It also makes a very nice hard shape. Now I'm very sorry, Jamie, that I didn't say hello to you, but I was so excited that Jane managed to get the wildebeest track right, which is fantastic. So well done again to all of you for guessing, and thank you for playing this little game with us. But let's go across to Jamie and say sorry to her for me for not waving.
No, she ran out.
Oh, no worries, Taylor. I didn't want to interrupt you. She just looked so deep in thought and engrossed with what she was saying, I decided I would go leave her uninterrupted. So we just snuck past with a quick wave, and thank goodness we did, because otherwise we would not have seen that gorgeous lilac-breasted roller in this morning sunlight. We see them so often that sometimes I think we start to take for granted the sheer beauty of those birds. I mean, they really are something out of this world. They're so gorgeous. The jewels of the bush, our birds. And sometimes we get so used to trying to search for rarities and something unique to add to your bird lists that sometimes we forget about our slightly more common feathered friends. That was beautiful, wasn't it, Brian? It was. Worthy of a Andrew Lloyd Webber song about all of its different colours. Glad Brian was on the same page. We have a question about, and I'm sorry, I missed the name completely because I was busy talking nonsense about musicals. Lucian. Lucian, yes, birds will eat tadpoles. Absolutely they will. Obviously the water birds are the most likely to go in search of fishing out various tadpole species from the water. So waders, herons, night herons, and various bird species of that sort of ilk. But kingfishers as well will swoop down. And kingfishers, despite their name, are actually large. Most of them are not fishers at all. In other words, they don't fish for... Obviously, they're not fishers. I mean fishers of fish. You know what I mean. Pied kingfisher and the giant kingfisher are the ones that actually go fishing. The rest of them are insect eaters, which is where I was going. But I think even a woodlands kingfisher, if it could, would swoop down and collect the puddle of tadpoles like the one that we saw. Which is why their approach to things... That swarm of tadpoles, to me, doesn't make sense. I know it's a safety and numbers thing to all gather like that in a big clump, but it doesn't quite make sense because... It surely makes you more, it makes you easier to spot and more vulnerable. Because now you all clump together. Whereas if they spread out a little bit, they might be harder to, I don't know, just one of those funny things in nature that doesn't quite make sense to me. But yeah, there are lots of birds that'll take advantage of the tadpole season. This time of year is for all of the animals, except perhaps the predators, it doesn't really apply to them. But this time of year is a very, very important time of year for every animal. They have got to take full advantage of the food sources that are available. For the snakes, that means the sort of explosion of frogs trying to bulk themselves up before they slow their metabolism down and go into winter. It is a bird that is very beautiful but does not have the prettiest call in the world. There's another one sitting on this tree making a noise. Birds, a lot of them are migratory species, so for them it means taking advantage of the termites and the frogs as well, and the insects to bulk up for the return journey home, wherever that may be. And for the herbivores, bulking up. See, it's not a very pretty call. One would expect a bird of this sort of image to come out with a beautiful lyrical song, but that seems to be... Oh, vanished. Well done. It seems to be a thing of the larks and the slightly more subtle coloured birds. Right, time to say a farewell to you all. I'm going to say goodbye and thank you, and a big thank you to Bebop for joining us. Thank you, Brian, and of course your thumb. Very happy looking thumb. We're going to send you over to Brent for the last few minutes.
Well, it hasn't been my morning, but what fantastic news. Two new lovely little dark black cute as a button little hyena cubs that have now joined the Djuma clan, which is always exciting. And of course, the great revelation that Ribbon was a female, not a boy. But anyway, that's one of those things out here. And well, there's always the possibility there's a male leopard on property. We're not sure where he is. I've got a sneaky suspicion it's Djuma, and he might have headed north again. But it could be Tingana, so he might pop out onto Central on his normal routes through. And the best thing as well, there are just elephants everywhere, and that is always wonderful to spend time with those great grey pachyderms. And well, we're just gonna have to see what the sunset safari holds. I'm hoping lots of Ellies, maybe some more hyenas, and maybe the Nkuhumas, who are lying up probably 60 meters from our boundary, decide to come back. But We're live, so you never know. We could have wild dogs, we could have cheetah. That's the best thing about being out here every day, live from the Greater Kruger. So from the Safari Live crew, Viam and myself, adieu and see you in a few hours.